Biology.
Yes, hello there and welcome to this class, whereby in this class our tutors will discuss about gaseous exchange. So what is gaseous exchange? It is defined as the process whereby respiratory gases will pass through respiratory surfaces. So you should never define gaseous exchange as the process where oxygen is taken in and carbon dioxide given out. That definition won't be correct, because a period of time we see that the plants take in carbon dioxide and give out oxygen. Therefore, the best definition will be is the process where respiratory gases, which is oxygen and carbon dioxide, passes through respiratory surface, whereby an example is the liver or the gills for the fish. So you see that the exchange is mainly brought out by the difference in concentration gradient between the living organism and the surrounding medium, whereby we see that in simple organisms, gaseous exchange is mainly through diffusion, while in higher organisms, gaseous exchange is mainly through special organs. But what is the importance of gaseous exchange? So the first importance, we see that it supplies oxygen necessary for respiration. Also through gaseous exchange, we see that carbon dioxide from the body is removed, that is from respiration. Also, the other importance of gaseous exchange is that it removes excess water in form of water vapor from the body. And lastly, we see that the other importance of gaseous exchange is that it provides carbon dioxide for the plants to be used for the photosynthetic process. So let's look at gaseous exchange in plants, whereby we see that gaseous exchange in plants mainly takes place through the stomata or the pneumatophores found in the mangroves, also through the lenticels, and finally through the cuticle. So let's first of all start with the first one, which is gaseous exchange through the stomata, whereby you see that a stomata is a very tiny opening on the leaf surface. It is bordered by the gut cells, whereby the function of the gut cells is to open and close the specific stomata. So the gut cells mainly exist in pairs, and gut cell cannot function on its own. So we see that the inner walls of the gut cells are thick and less elastic than the outer walls. So this mainly causes the outer walls to stretch outwards in order to accommodate enough water molecules through the stretching. So when the gut cells become turgid, the stomata will eventually open. So most of the stomata are mainly found on the lower part of the leaf than the upper parts of the leaf. But however, the distribution of the stomata is mainly related to the habitat of the plant. Is it a xerophyte, is it a mesophyte, or is it a hydrophyte? So basically we see that the stomata mainly allows gaseous exchange to take place in the plant. So let's now look at the theories for the opening and closing of the stomata, whereby the first theory we have is the potassium ion theory. The second theory is the photosynthetic theory from photosynthesis. And lastly, we have the sugar starch interconversion theory. So let's begin with the first theory, which is the potassium ion theory, whereby we see that the energy released from photosynthesis drives potassium ion from the adjacent cell, from the adjacent epidermal cell into the gut cell, while hydrogen ions will eventually move out. So the accumulation of potassium ion in the gut cells, however, raises the osmotic pressure, and the gut cell will absorb even more water, become turgid, and then finally open the stomata. What about at night or in the absence of light? So in the absence of light, we see that the ATP molecules falls, thus there is no energy for the potassium ion pump to function adequately. So in this case, the potassium will move out of the gut cell to the surrounding epidermal cells by the process of diffusion. On the other hand, we see that the hydrogen ions will move into the gut cells, as this lowers the osmotic pressure of the gut cells, thus making them to lose even more water. So again, as this happens, we'll see that the stomata will finally close. So let's look at the next theory, which is the photosynthetic theory. So photosynthetic theory originates from the process of photosynthesis, whereby you see that during the day, the chloroplast of the gut cells produces sugars through photosynthesis. So this sugar mainly they cause the osmotic pressure of the vacuole to increase. And as this happens, the cells draw even more water from the neighboring epidermal cells. So the gut cells become turgid and bulge outward, making the stomata to finally open. What happens at night or in the absence of light? So the absence of light, you see that the sugar is converted to starch and accumulates in the gut cell. So as this happens, you see that it will lower the osmotic pressure of the gut cell. So the cell will then lose water, to the surrounding epidermal cells, as the gut cells will become plasmolyzed, thereby leading to the closure of the stomata. So lastly, let's look at the last theory, which is now the sugar starch interconversion theory, whereby we see that during the day, the carbon dioxide is used for photosynthesis and the pH will finally become very high. So the increase in pH mainly favors the conversion of starch to glucose. So since glucose is osmotically active, it brings about the increase in the osmotic pressure, making the gut cells to draw water from the adjacent epidermal cells. So this then leads to the opening of the stomata. And again, as the rest, what happens at night or in the absence of light? So at night you see that photosynthesis does not take place and therefore carbon dioxide is barely used up. So here, the pH will be very low. So the low pH mainly favors the conversion of now glucose into starch, and that is the dark stage of photosynthesis. So the presence of starch will however discourage water intake, thus the gut cell will become flaccid, leading to the closure of the stomata. So finally, let's look at the mechanism of gaseous exchange in plants. So how does gaseous exchange mainly take place in plants? So you see that when the stomata opens, the carbon dioxide from the atmosphere diffuses into the substomatal air chambers. So from here, it moves to the intercellular spaces in the spongy mesophyll, whereby the carbon dioxide goes into solution form, therefore diffusing into the cytoplasm. So a concentration gradient is maintained between the cytoplasm and the intercellular space. And here, we see that carbon dioxide then diffuses into the cell. On the other hand, we see that the oxygen produced during photosynthesis moves out of the cell and into the intercellular air spaces. It then moves to the substomatal air chambers and diffuses out through the stomata. So finally, again, let's look at now the stomatal habitats of different plants, whereby we see that the stomata varies with the specific habitat that the plant is living, be it a hydrophyte, be it a mesophyte, or be it a xerophyte. So we see that different plants have different sizes and numbers of stomata, whereby let's first of all look at the hydrophytes, and we'll note that for the hydrophytes, it has very many stomata on the upper and the lower parts of the leaf. Let's now look at the xerophytes, whereby for the xerophytes, we see that it has very few or no stomata on the upper parts or on the lower parts of the leaf. And then finally, we have the mesophytes, whereby these are mainly the plants that live in moist areas, whereby it is moderate and the size of the stomata varies from being medium to large, being found on the upper or the lower parts of the leaf. So let's now meet on the next class as we now discuss more on the adaptations of these plants growing in different habitats. Biology.